The gracious creation divided up. Catch this glimpse. You can read this, it'll be on the screen. Revelation 4. John gives just a glimpse into this new creation and what it's been like to worship the Lord Jesus. Whenever the living creatures of glory, honor, and thanks to him who sits on the throne and who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before Jesus and worship him who lives forever. And they lay their crown on the throne and say, "You are worthy, our Lord and God, to honor your glory and honor and power. You created all things, and by your will." Join the crowd this morning.
Be sure to see Miss Rhonda over there, hit Miss Rhonda, and let her know, hey, I want to you have any questions about that, and mark your calendar March 7th. Also, want to mention the 14 card commitment card. We handed these out last week in our outdoor service. You can still pick those up if you have a misplaced yours or didn't get one. They're out here on the Welcome Center. Time, talent, treasure. Tell the story of Jesus. You see the heart here of being committed, a committed church member here at Green Acres. We bring these back on March the 7th. It says March the 1st there, but you understand my heart, right? March the 7th, all right? And then last but not least, thank you, Charles. Appreciate that. Marty Courtright has these flowers here, and they are in loving memory of her husband, George. So pretty cool to see that. We've not seen Margie in a little while, but I'm glad that she's still with us. If you want to mention those online, hello to them again. Good to have you here this morning, even though you're at home digitally with us. So there's a couple ways to give. You can give financially, either through PushPay, you can bring it, drop it in the sign box here. We've got a box here, or the PO box. So there's a couple ways to be able to give here and stay faithful financially. Could you pray for us? All right, you stand, kind of greet one another, standing in place, and then Keith and the band will continue to lead us. Father, we're thankful to gather this morning and think of love, not as the world knows love, but think of true, real, everlasting love that is unconditional and constantly coming at us from you, God. You love us so much so that we know that crimson blood was spilled from the cross of Christ, and we thank you for that. So we gather this morning to worship, to lift up the name of Jesus, to be together, one family, young and old, all together under one roof to worship the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for your goodness and your grace to us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together, greet those just around and give them a wave and a hello, and then the band will get us going.
somebody who's encountered the presence of God. And Isaiah, after saying what we just sang, holy, 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 he immediately responds with this. You can see it on the screen from Isaiah 6. Woe to me, I cry. I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. And my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty. Have you ever been somewhere, maybe a party or an event, where you didn't know what the expected dress code was? And you showed up feeling a little bit underdressed, maybe a little bit embarrassed, vulnerable, exposed, maybe. Well, in the same way, I think that's the idea of what we're supposed to get. When we encounter the holiness, the grandeur, the greatness, that which we can never measure up to, we're reminded of the ways that we don't meet that standard of holiness. So in an act of confession, let's just take a moment on our own in silence to reflect back on the past week. Confession is not just morbid introspection. It's not just like a cosmic beatdown. It's just a time for us to move forward, continuing to move forward towards God with a spirit of humbleness, reflecting on the fact that we are not God, that we're not the gods of our own lives. It's actually in that moment that we find the forgiveness and the transformation that Jesus wants to offer to us. So in silence, let's take just a moment and reflect back on the past week. Let me remind you that even while we stand in a vulnerable space like this before our Creator, we are safe in the love and the care of God. The God we know in Jesus Christ is a God who expresses himself in our world through mercy. And to that we say, praise the Lord. Remember the kindness of God that leads us to repentance and to change, and let that open you up towards the Spirit's working in the world and in our own lives. We're continuing to learn songs from the book of Luke. I want to teach you a new song today. We'll sing it over the next few weeks a few times, so you'll get it. It's a pretty easy song anyway. But I'm going to teach you the chorus, and then we'll sing the chorus again all together, and then we'll jump into the song. It sounds like this.
Come to the feast, come to the table, the great and the least, the rich and the poor. Come to the feast. Come to the table, come and hunger no more.
acknowledging God's goodness towards us. Let's pray this prayer of thanksgiving together from Revelation 5. Please read the underlined parts out loud with me. You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased for God persons from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God, and they will reign on the earth. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb, by praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever.
Wake up till I lay my head.
Take your Bible and turn to Luke chapter 2. Thank you, Keith and Van. Good to have Kenny and Van back. Yeah, amen. Yeah, please pray for them. Slowly but surely. Luke chapter 2 is where we're at this morning. We took a little bit of a break for our outdoor service, and as I mentioned a minute ago, we picked up our 4T commitment. I believe what my body is his local church. So Luke chapter 2, and this morning is a really neat story. I mean, it's really, really cool, if you will. I mean, other gospels don't have this story. Luke telling the story of Jesus as a 12-year-old boy. So that's what we're going to look at. Just before we get into this, just think of all that we've already read so far. I mean, we're taking our time, but we've come through the story of Jesus. We even think back to the very beginning where Luke is writing, and he's writing verse 4 of chapter 1, that you might have certainty of who Jesus is. You know, I just finished up seminary. I kind of went around the back way, if you will. Some guys, they graduate college, they go off to Bible school. My mom told me maybe I should do that, but I didn't. I went to Florida State and kind of found my way to the church. I knew that the Lord had called me into ministry in college, but pastored before seminary and going to Southern up in Louisville was my chance to go. And I had come across a lot of guys who knew a lot of things. I mean, they knew the Bible, and were probably better than I. But I'm like, I'm picking up for the first time when I'm preaching. I don't want that to discourage you anyway. I just try to catch it fresh and read it. Maybe that's the first time I'm reading it. You know, this is what I'm saying. I don't want us to be so knowledgeable when we forget the heart of Scripture. I found a lot of people that can tell you a lot of things, but they can't show you that they love Jesus. And so it stops right there. If you want your people, your children, to love Jesus, you love Jesus. I can spend all day long teaching my children the Bible and all that, but if they don't see that, I really believe it. And I love the Lord Jesus. They won't believe it. So I'm just throwing that out there. I mean, I don't know why that came out of me, but I just wanted to say I don't want to get caught in just all the facts and figures. I really want us to love Jesus. Alright, so stand with me in the honor of reading the Word of God, and we'll get started. Sorry, man, I just was worshiping with you and just emotional in that moment, and I'm trying to recover here. Alright, so Luke chapter 2, and we'll get on to verse 41 and finish in 52. The boy Jesus in the temple. Now his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of Passover, and when he was 12 years old, they went up according to custom. But when the feast that was ended, as they were returning, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. His parents did not know it, but supposing him to be with the group, they went on a day's journey. But then they began to search for him among his relatives and acquaintances. And when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem searching for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. And when his parents saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us so? Behold, your father and I have been searching for you in great distress." And he said to them, "Why were you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house?" And they did not understand what he was saying when he spoke to them. And he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was submissive to them. And his mother treasured up all these things in her heart. Verse 52, and Jesus increased in wisdom and in stature in the favor of God and man. Let's pray. Father, thank you for our time we gather together. Thank you for your word. We do worship you, Lord Jesus, not only in song, but we worship you with our lives. don't want to be religious. We want to be devoted. Lovers of you. Followers of you. Obeying all of your commands by your Spirit. So help us to do so. Amen. Be seated. This is really neat because when you look at it, 12 years have passed from verse 40. I didn't read that. From verse 40 to 41. Look back real quick. Verse 40 says, and the child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon them. 12 years have passed since we read that verse, not literally, but here when Luke records it. 12 years have passed from verse 40 to 41. Another 18 years will pass from the end of chapter 2 this morning to chapter 3, as we'll come to next week. I'm just giving you a bit of a timeline, if you will, how Luke is giving us this story. We get Jesus as baby in the manger. We get Jesus as being dedicated at the temple. Here Luke gives us Jesus age 12, and then we don't get him again until he's an adult man. So what is Luke saying to us? I think that's the point there. What is he leading us to see this morning? Verse 41 to 42, take a look in your Bibles. They're going to Passover. This is Mary and Joseph. They're celebrating the birth of Israel's freedom from Exodus. Do you remember how God provided for his people? He delivered them from the Egyptians. He did so with blood. If you remember that story, they were instructed to put the blood of the lamb over the door and that every firstborn would be killed. But if the blood of the lamb was over the door, the child would be spared. And they're celebrating the blood. Isn't that what we do? Celebrate the blood? The people of God have always celebrated the blood because they were celebrating God's provision for them. That God rescued them. It's the same thing we do, just in case you didn't catch on. We celebrate the blood. We celebrate how God rescued us. They were going to Passover, Israel's birthday, if you will, freedom from Exodus. Men were required to attend, so it makes sense that Joseph is going, but women were not. But Mary is there. What that says to us is that both Joseph and Mary were devoted to the Lord. This was a godly family. In case you didn't catch this, that's what Luke's doing. He's showing us people who are devoted to the Lord. Zachariah, Elizabeth, Simeon, Anna, people devoted to the Lord. They're there. They're going. You see, as we look here in the scripture, we're only in chapter 2, we see a devoted family. They love the Lord. They obey him. An angel appeared to Mary. I mean, can you imagine if an angel appeared to you? You might show up too, right? So there, an angel appears to Mary, also to Joseph. There's confirmation from Elizabeth and Zachariah, and then they go to the temple to dedicate the Lord Jesus. And there's Simeon and Anna, and they're prophesying, and they're saying, this is the Christ. They're living into their devotion. I know many who have experienced moments of spiritual high, and they're not around to speak of it today. So I'm not talking about a moment. I'm not talking about goosebumps, because the Lord can show up and do great things, but people can forget that quickly. We were forgetful people, but they didn't forget. They were devoted, and they continued to follow the Lord. All of Scripture was pointing to Jesus. They were fully devoted followers of the Lord. That's what Luke's doing. He's showing us devotion. So write that down. If you're taking notes, this is the only screen you'll see today. Devotion. Luke showing us devoted people, devoted families, a devoted life is more than a moment or an experience or an event. Listen to this. A.W. Tozer says it this way. If you can't worship God 6 days out of the week, then you can't worship God one day out of 43 to 46. 3 days, perhaps, your Bible says. They're in a bit of a caravan, if you will. They're traveling with family members. So someone would say, Mary, how did you lose Jesus? I mean, come on. Well, there's a lot of people around. I mean, he could have been playing with his nieces and nephews or cousins or family members. We don't know exactly. It reminds me of that scene in Home Alone. Anybody? 90s? And they're counting, and they're about to go on a trip to New York, I believe. I think I'm one or two. I can't remember. They're counting the men, and you remember the neighbor kid comes over, and he's going through their bags. Like, what neighbor kid does that? Like, get out of here. Go home, man. He's grumbling to the bags, and they're counting the kids, and they count the neighbor, and they think it's seven. It's kind of like that. They don't realize that Jesus is not there until it's too late, and Mary is not saying seven. She's saying Jesus, right? The Bible goes on to tell us where he is. He's in his Father's house. He's in the temple. And the Bible uses this word sitting. I want you to just underline that. It's just in little detail. But it tells us that he is sitting. And typically in Old Testament times, as teachers would teach, the teacher would be sitting and the pupils would be standing. Jesus is sitting. You're listening to him. But not only is Jesus teaching, but the Bible says he's listening to them and asking them questions. He's learning. He's a 12-year-old boy, and he's learning. So who in here is 12 years old? I'm just curious. Any 12-year-olds? And 11? 11? Okay, we got an 11-year-old here. Okay. You're close. And even older, you can listen and ask good questions. I mean, I know it, with my own children, they're like sponges, and they sometimes ask better questions than you all. They're absorbing all that's going on. But there's something I wanted to wrestle with a little bit, and I need to lay this out for you as we just think of Jesus as a 12-year-old boy, is his divineness, that he was fully God and fully man. I don't want us to lose this doctrine or this understanding. We do need to stop and realize that Jesus is 12. The gospel gives us this. Other gospels don't. Luke does. But I want us to think about his humanness. He was a 12-year-old boy, but did he know he was God? We don't know exactly. The Bible tells us that though he was God, there were some things he did not know. For example, Matthew 24, verse 36. Speaking about the end times, Matthew says, no one will know the day nor hour, not even Christ himself. Christ will return, and he won't even know when it is time to return. Only God will know. So if we're asking that question, what does Jesus know? What is the knowledge that Christ has? Michael Wilkins, he's a professor at Loyola, and he says this. This limited knowledge of Jesus does not make him less divine. Jesus learned things as other humans learn. Yet it is a mystery how Jesus could have limited knowledge, human, yet know all things God. Maybe, this is interesting, maybe Jesus regularly lived on the basis of his human knowledge, but could at any time call to mind anything from his infinite knowledge. What is important is that we hold this doctrine of fully God, fully man. The second person of the Trinity, the Logos, never changes. Some would say it this way. Out of free grace, Jesus became a man 2 millennia ago by assuming himself a true body and a reasonable soul. Or, as the Chaldean Creed puts it, this is 451 AD, they point out the humanity and the deity of Christ. The important affirmation and phrase that summarizes this one person, two natures. Now and forever, two completely different natures, divine and human, are united in one Son of God. As a man, then the Son increased in wisdom, stature, and in favor with God and man. And like human being, named after the boy, he became hungry. Jesus hungered. He grew tired, the Bible tells us. He felt distressed, and yet was amazed at what he learned. Jesus, our Lord, learned. So, just putting that out there. A little nerdy for a moment. We need to understand what's happening here. I don't want to slip off in weird places. Jesus, fully God, fully man, to meditate the message what we hold to 2,000, speak about education and the importance of education. That's what Jesus was doing. He was being educated, and education is a part of being devoted. Full devotion to the Lord. Maybe that's why I said what I did at the beginning of the sermon. Jesus was 100% God and 100% man. He was not 50% God and 50% man, 100% God and 100% man. You do the math. It's called the hypostatic union in it. Anyways, we'll talk about it later. Jesus, 12 years old, in Jewish culture, was the year that you apprenticed with your father. As a Jewish boy, this was the year before you turned 13 and are regarded ready to observe religious practices and eligible to take part in worship within the religious initiation ceremony, the bar mitzvah. You probably know that. But I believe this text is modeling for us the principle of thresholds. And what I mean by that is I believe that there should be markers in a person's life between boy and man, or girl and woman, a deep need for instruction, talking to your children, your 12-year-old, about sexuality, integrity, identity, purpose. We've lost many of these things in our lives. We expect that maybe someone else will tell them. Or they'll go through that class in school. No, you tell them who they are. You tell them who they are before someone else does. We've lost that. It was built in to their culture. We see that here in this text. Jesus, 12 years old. I think we lowered the bar for our youth. I think if we think about our 12-year-olds as middle schoolers, only capable of playing video games and wearing deodorant, then we've lost our way. They're waiting. They're ready to be molded. If they are old enough to do wrong, they are old enough to do right. That's what the Bible is showing us. Jesus devoted. 1 Timothy 4:12, do not let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for believers in speech and conduct and love and faith and in purity. Psalm 119, how can a young man keep his way pure? By guarding it according to the word. The Bible does not expect any less of us. The Bible actually speaks to the 12-year-old and to all of us, calling us to be devoted. God uses people who are young to stir up people of all ages. Listen to this. In 1806, at Williams College, 5 students began to pray for the cause of foreign missions. Until then, the missionary organizations in the U.S. were solely dedicated to domestic missions, both in the Western frontier and among the Native American tribes. But these students, they prayed that the Lord would raise up men to take the gospel to other nations. They were known as the Haystack Five. You ever heard about the Haystack Five? A prayer meeting, a revival even. These young men, not yet enrolled in seminary, not even graduated from no worldly power or resources. They held no official position in the church, and yet they were so moved by the desire to effect mission or missions to the heathen that they began to organize missionary society among Temple College campuses, encouraging other students to pray for the cause of missions. After this, they repeatedly visited influential ministers in their day, eventually prevailing on those men to form a mission board. And then in 1816, one of the Haystack organizers, Samuel Mills, died at sea on his return voyage from Africa. His legacy included people from all ages partnering in missions throughout the world. At the time of his death, he was 35. God uses young people to stir up people of all ages, fully devoted to God. But here's what I believe is all over this text. If you're taking notes, now's the time. Jesus is devoted to the Father, verse 48. And when his parents saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us so? Behold, your father and I have been searching for you in great distress." And he said to them, "Why are you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house?" And they did not understand the saying that he spoke to them. Mary is distressed, the Bible says. She's frantic. Can you imagine bearing the Lord Jesus Christ and then all of a sudden losing him? Like, big fail. Birthing the Son of God and then losing him, but he was not lost. Jesus was not lost. Jesus gently reminds his mother that Joseph is not his father. Joseph's not his father in a primary way, but God is his father. He says in verse 49, "I must be in my father's house." Translated literally, "I must be about my father's business." There's a strong magnetic pull in the heart and life of Jesus. He must do what God has called him to do. I looked up this week. I was curious, the strongest magnetic pull in the world right now, like the strongest magnet, you know where it is? I know this is a bad word to say in Athens, Georgia, but it's down in Florida State University. And there is the magnetic field laboratory, MagLab, Florida State, and they run the strongest continuous magnet used by scientists. You know how strong it is? It's 45 Tesla. Didn't even know Tesla was a measurement, but it is. It's 45 Tesla, around 10 times stronger than a hospital's MRI machine. And now they're working, researchers, on creating a 45.5 Tesla magnet. Interesting, right? I believe there's this magnetic pull in the heart of Jesus. He must do the will of the Father. That's what he says here to his mother. "I must be about my father's business." John 4:34, "My food," Jesus says, "is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work." Psalm 6:38, "For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but to do the will of the one who sent me." This is the life of Jesus. We mustn't think that Jesus was normally constrained by his Father's will over against his own desires. No, Jesus longed to please the Father. It made him happy to please the Father with the Holy Spirit. So that's the question. Do we long to be about the Father's business? If Jesus is our Lord, he is our Master, and we are live lives of following Jesus, do we long to be about the Father's business? Is there a strong magnetic pull in us to do the will of the Father? Are we about talks about driving down the road, and sometimes he has to pull off the side of the road because he has an idea. And that idea says to him, you must create me. It's kind of a joke that's haunting, where he has to pull off the side of the road and kind of sketch the idea where it won't leave his mind. He has to get that idea down. I believe that's kind of what's happening here in Jesus' life. There is this override, this desire, if you will, but it's not robotic. It is a genuine longing to do the Father's will, to be about the Father's business. Are we longing to do the Father's will? The Christian life is to be about the Father's business. Burden for the lost. A zeal for His church. A desire to reach the nations. A reconciler, not wanting division among the body between brother or sister. A kingdom bridge builder. That's the Christian life. With our Lord, Jesus, was all about the Father's business. So should we. So should we long to be about what God is about. So should we love His church, His people. So should we seek the kingdom bridge builder. And then verse 51, take a look in your Bibles. Verse 51 says, Jesus went down with them and came to Nazareth and was submissive to them. And his mother treasured up all these things in her heart. If you're writing those again, the first is this, Jesus' devotion to the Father. Respect for the Father. The second is this, Jesus, the Son of God, was submissive. Respect and submission. Jesus was submissive to his earthly parents because it was his way of submitting to his heavenly Father. Surely we must do the same. Christians must understand and speak and live in the knowledge that while authority is often abused here in this fallen world, it is fundamentally a gift from God. If there is an abuse of parent, an abuse of boss, an abuse of official, or even an abuse of pastor, it shouldn't be ignored. Authority is good, but for it to be abused, you cannot ignore that. It is a gift from God for flourishing. Maybe you pay attention to all of the findings that have come out in just this weekend on Ravi Zacharias. An apologist, a man who spoke about the deep things of God, more of a philosopher, if you will. And it was found out that he abused his power incredibly. And sickening, sad ways. And so I understand, if I even say this, as we might even consider the submission of Jesus, I realize that it is abused authority in our land, in our world. But we ought not think that it's any different in the world of Jesus. As Luke writes this, this is the human heart. If there is abuse, it must be exposed. Or how can we submit rightly to authority if authority is abusive? Authority is good and a gift from God so that we flourish. But we cannot allow abusive authority to have. The problem is this. The problem when we think about submission and Jesus and even in our own lives is that we realize that we are not like Jesus. We do not always delight in doing the will of our Heavenly Father. We often long to be free from God's will. Imagining that we would be happier if we could have our own way. Why is that? why is it that we rebel and go astray? Christians are sometimes the worst offender when it comes to disrespect of God in authority. Why is that? We are happy to obey our leaders in church, Hebrews 13:17, so long as they don't instruct us to do anything we don't want to do. We respect those who rule over us in government, Romans 13:1, so long as they enact and enforce the policies we advocate. Wives, submit to their husbands, Ephesians 5:22 to 24, so long as they are getting what they want. So what is this side against submission? I believe Jesus helps us. Jesus corrects our behavior. Jesus demonstrates what it looks like to do the will of the Father, to be fully devoted and respect the Father, yet also submissive to his earthly parents. But in the end, it condemns us. It reveals how much we fail, how rebellious we are, how we are not devoted to the Lord. Jesus' obedience points out our failure. When we see Jesus' example, we see that we are not righteous in and of ourselves. We need a righteousness and obedience that is outside of ourselves. This is the gospel. Listen, Jesus Christ came to earth. He lived the life that we should have lived, and he died the death that we should have died. If you don't hear anything else this morning, hear this. You can't do it. Prideful. Any kind of authority comes into your life, you're trying to subvert it. You're not devoted to the Lord. There's so much inconsistency in this room. We say, I'm going to be fully devoted to the Lord. And that lasts for a week. But that's the gospel. The good news is that Jesus came to this earth. He lived the life we should live, and he died the death we should have died. That's the gospel. That's the good news, is that there's nothing good in you, but everything good comes through Christ. That is Christ in you. If you are a Christian, you are righteous before God. You stand before the Lord, and he sees his Son Jesus. All of your failures are met in Christ. You feel the grace. You feel the mercy. Where you should be devoted to the Lord and can't be, Jesus was and is. Where you should submit to authority and fail to do so, went to the cross. Verse 51. While it might seem to us a small detail, Jesus' submission, think about this. His obedience to his parents leads to salvation. You say, well, how do you get that? If Jesus had not been obedient to his parents, he would not have been the perfect, holy sacrifice to go to the cross. The Bible requires and calls for a pure and spotless lamb, and Jesus was. He was without sin in every way. Jesus was obedient. He went to the cross for you and for me. If he were not the obedient child that you and I should have been, he would not possess the righteousness that he is only able to give to those who trust him. Take your Bibles and turn with me to Romans chapter 5 quickly. 5. I want you to see this thing and mark this verse. Romans 5, and I'm going to read verses 18 to 21. All of this is chock full of the gospel so that we might understand that we are sinners and separated from God, but God rescued us through His Son Jesus. Romans 5, 18. Therefore, as one trespass, sin, as one trespass led to condemnation for all men, so one act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all men. For as by the one man's disobedience, the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience, the many were made righteous. Now the law came in to increase the trespass, but where sin increased, grace abounded all the more. So that as sin reigned in death, grace also might reign through righteousness, leading to eternal life through Jesus Christ. Nothing in you that can save you. Matter of fact, by getting blood on you and trying to get it off, and you start wiping it all over yourself. But as the Bible says, just as sin came through one man's disobedience, righteousness came through one. Lord Jesus Christ, made atonement for our sin. And as the Bible says, there is no forgiveness of sin without the shedding of blood. And Jesus shed His blood for our sin. And when you cry out to the Lord Jesus, I'll forgive. I repent of my sin. I need your cleansing. Your forgiveness. The Bible says in 1 John 1:9 that if you confess your sin, He is faithful and just. He is faithful and just to forgive you of your sin and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Isn't that good news? So what might seem like a small detail here in the Bible, like Jesus submitting to His parents, actually is in some ways a foreshadowing of the gospel. This is the cross coming in Luke's gospel. Here Jesus is just a 12-year-old boy, but we get a glimpse of Jesus fully devoted to the Father. He's 100% devoted to the Father, and He is submitted to His parents. Jesus devoted to God the Father and submissive to authority. Think. It would eventually be Jesus' devotion to the Father and His submission to authority that would hang Him on the cross. Pierced for our transgressions. Blood flowed down for our sins. Jesus' devotion to cover apathy and lack of interest. Jesus' obedience to cover rebellion and foolishness. Jesus' submission to cover pride and arrogance. May we seek Christ for you. Come before His throne. And Jesus, you died for my sins. And you would receive the righteousness, the imputed righteousness of Christ. Not a righteousness of your own, but one that is only found in Him. rebellious ways, prideful ways, and walking in the way of Jesus. Jesus was fully devoted to the Father and submissive to his parents. His parents. Lord Jesus, we do thank you. Fully God, fully man. We thank you that you submitted yourself to the human body. Even a 12-year-old boy. To show us the way of devotion to the Father. To show us humble submission. How would you help us live like Jesus? And we recognize there's nothing good in us. We cannot on our own. We're powerless. Every time we try, it's never good. We believe your Spirit will help us, convicting us of sin. We may lay it aside and we would walk in the Spirit and live lives that look like Jesus. And time again, we still may fail. We are picked up and led by you and helped. So help us to do so. Help us to live lives that are truly devoted to you and submitted to one another and authority, your church, government, and in our own marriages, to live humble lives that honor you. Maybe you're this morning, you need a prayer. You say, Pastor, can we just pray for me? You know what's going on. The Lord knows what's going on in my life. I just need to acknowledge that. Every head is bowed and every eye is closed. If you're here this morning, you need to lift up your hand and say, Pastor Cameron, pray for me. Amen. Amen. All across the room. Amen. I see. Amen. Let's pray now. Father, help us. You know every person here, even those that raise their hand, Lord, just help them, whatever situation they may be going through, God, you are with us. And I pray that they might sense your presence day to day, your nearness. I pray that you might help them be more devoted to you and walk in your ways, Lord God, thank you. For those grieving, that's hurting, for those in sin, oh God, work. Here this morning, you need to trust in Jesus. You need to give your life to Jesus today. Again, no one is looking. I want you to just raise your hand, your head bowed, your eye closed. You say, today is the day of salvation. I've never trusted in Jesus. But I've fallen under conviction today. I need to give my life to the Lord Jesus Christ. If that's you this morning, lift up your hand. You just come talk after church. I'd be glad to hang around and talk about how God's working in your life. So, Father, help us. Would you help us live lives? It's shine the light of Christ. Help us live lives devoted to you, Lord. Oh, God. We need you. Help us be examples. You in this world, in this lost world. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Let's stand together. Keith and the band will continue to lead us.
I hear.
Help us, not to be religious, but to be devoted. devoted followers of Jesus. As we go from this place, help us to walk in your spirit. And use us, God, use us to be the hands and feet of Jesus on mission this week. Whether that be with a family member or a co-worker or someone we come in contact with, use us to speak about the goodness of God and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, Father, for our time together. Be with us as we go. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Well, this comes from the back, left to right, and